My name is Michael Förster, and it's good to be here today. I would like to talk to you about the role of airtightness in buildings in general, because the airtightness is the main reason for energy savings, avoiding building damages and mold, and I would like to give you examples why this is happening when you install the airtightness layer properly. So at first, who is Proclima? Which is, I think, a good introduction of the company, who is Proclima, because we are producing all these building materials. We try to find solutions for every detail. And some people say that we are a little bit too keen on finding solutions for every gap that could occur within the airtightness layer. But from my point of view, it's very interesting and important to have a solution available for every detail, because this is leading to a very good and high durable airtightness layer that could last for the next decades. So if you've got only one tape and one membrane and one glue, then of course you could achieve airtightness, but it's not leading to a good result. It's one result. That's why we are developing constantly a lot of products. We are producing every year a couple of products to make it more easy to achieve airtightness. Yes, and to find a good solution for your constructions. Airtightness is just one of the topics that we are following. We've got also an assortment of roof underlays that we are selling throughout the world, in the UK, for instance, in Germany and in many other countries in Europe and overseas. This will be a topic later on. I will have another presentation about roof underlays. We are also having solutions for refurbishment situations, of course. There needs to be done. There has to be done a lot of refurbishments. There are a lot of houses that are leaky concerning airtightness that need an extra protection layer against the weathering, and that's what we can deliver products for. And we also have a system for making walls weathertight at the outside. So this is just a short introduction of what Proclima is doing. We are doing this since the middle of the 80s. Mr. Moll introduced the first airtightness materials in 1986, so more than 30 years we are now have experiences with airtightness materials. So, and the company has got about 120 employees at this moment, so a lot of people are working, developing, marketing, whatever, distributing the materials all over the world in more than 35 countries. Yeah, that's my short description of the company. And now let's start with airtightness. And this is the most important point. And actually, I brought this umbrella to Belfast because we've had a lot of rain here. We are lucky in Birmingham because it's not raining. But the umbrella is protecting us against rain. So, but what does the water do in our construction? So if we've got a timber frame construction, then we need a protection as well. Not only against rain, but at the building sites, you have got a lot of moisture that could occur. And I will give you some examples. What are the sources for the moisture affecting our constructions? This is another situation that I want to show to you, because below the snow, the timber for the next roof construction is hidden. Is this a good situation? Is it good for the timber to be hidden under the snow? To store it under the snow? It's a kind of protection layer, isn't it? No, it isn't, because this timber will be very wet. Before installation, you have to dry it. You have to wait for a couple of months until it's dried again. So this is not a good situation, but it could occur. So sometimes the timber is being stored under these conditions, and actually you are supposed to install dry timber, pre-dried timber. It's the best, I think, 18% maximum of relative humidity, then it will be a good construction. Another source for moisture affecting our construction is the person who lays the screed, the people who are installing the plaster at the inside of walls. We have to prepare our constructions for the moisture that could occur during the building time as well. So store the materials in a dry place, of course, cover them with whatever, a foil to protect them against the weathering. But at the building sites, we've got also the problem that moisture is being installed regularly. It's normal. We need water to install the screed. We need water to plaster the walls. So this is another source, and we have to make sure that this will not get into our constructions, into our insulation layers. Another example for moisture, because As I mentioned, timber is not dry when you install it. Timber could contain, if it's pre-dried timber, 18% relative humidity, which is a moisture source, because when you install the timber and it dries to 10 or 12%, which is a usual number of humidity level, then 1% drying releases 100 grams per square meter of moisture. So reducing the moisture content of the timber from 18 to 10% releases 800 grams of water per square meter of construction. And you have to make sure that the moisture could dry out to the outside due to diffusion of materials, and maybe as well to the inside, where you have activated another dry out layer, which could be very important for the security of the construction. In general, insulation is working like a knitted sweater. So if you are feeling cold and you think, okay, now it's autumn or winter, then you're carrying your knitted sweater. But if you go outside, you leave the building, and then you go out and some wind is getting into your clothes, then you think, okay, it's still cold, because you don't have an airtightness layer. If you just add a windbreaker and close the zipper, then though the windbreaker is not offering, it's not an insulation layer. In addition, it's an insulation layer. It's getting warmer because you are not allowing the wind to touch the surface of your skin. So this is the situation that is described below. This is what we need the airtightness layer for. We have to protect the insulation layer against the wind from getting into the fibers. So this is the principle of insulation. If we move this consideration to our construction, then we have got a windtight layer at the outside, a fully insulated space between the rafters. That's what we recommend to fulfill the requirements of the governmental regulations. And at the inside of the construction, you have got the airtightness layer. And does somebody know the difference between the airtightness and wind tightness layer? So the airtightness layer has to be airtight. So you can prove it with a pressure test. Niall already mentioned it. And you should prove it, because airtightness could not be checked visually. It's only possible to say that the building is airtight if you've proven it with a blower door, for instance. And the wind tightness layer at the outside doesn't have to be airtight, but it's useful to glue the overlappings with the tape, to glue the membrane to chimneys and roof windows, because then you can make sure that the wind is not able to enter the construction and reduce the effectivity of the insulation layer. Because in Austria, they found out that taping the overlappings of a roof underlay and sealing the connections to adjacent building materials is increasing the performance of the insulation. It doesn't need to be airtight, just glue everything as good as possible. You don't have to achieve airtightness, and this is increasing the performance of the insulation layer that you have installed. Because heat losses are a problem for the effectivity of our buildings. At the end of the 19th of the last century, a laboratory test was performed in Stuttgart at the Institute for Building Physics, and they installed insulation layer in a kind of window, so, and put a airtightness layer in front of it. On this side of the airtightness layer, we've got room temperature of about 20 degrees. Just imagine there is a hole in the wall and we filled it with fibrous insulation. And on the opposite side of the insulation layer, they've had minus 10 degrees. And they measured the U value. And in this situation, they got as a result 0.3 watt per square meter in Kelvin, which is quite weak for the current situations, but in the end of the 90s, it has been rather good. And then they added a gap, just 1 millimeter thick, length 1 meter, this gap. And then they measured the U value again, and they found out that there has been a performance down of about 5 due to this small gap, due to the leakage that they caused within the airtightness layer. And the resulting U value of 1.44 could be compared with a masonry wall of about 40 or 45 centimeters thickness. So therefore, it seems to be that if you have a gap, a leak in your airtightness layer, that the performance of the insulation that you've installed is similar in comparison with an uninsulated masonry wall. So in this situation, you don't have effectivity of the insulation due to the leakage that you have produced due to this gap. So this is one reason for sealing every gap, every connection to adjacent materials in the air tightness layer, let's say tubes, chimneys, windows. That's why we want to save energy, and we want to avoid heat losses because they are affecting our U values of the constructions. Another problem is that leaky air tightness layers could lead to structural damages. So this is a good example, because here you can see that the timber decking starts to rot. There has been a bituminous felt at the outside, so the construction has been diffusion tight at the outside. And at the inside, the experts found leakages within the air tightness layer. So the moisture went into the construction and was trapped due to the bituminous felt at the outside. That's the problem in this situation, and we have to avoid it. And I know that a lot of constructions in the UK have got flat roof membranes at the outside. So you have to make sure that the moisture is not being trapped in your construction, and you have to find a solution to get rid of it again if it's entered once the construction. This brings me to another example, to another test that they have performed at the University, at the Institute of Buildings for Building Civil Physics in Stuttgart. they not only have had an air tightness layer, they have had vapor check with an SD value of 30 meters, which is a rather good vapor check and prevents the moisture from entering the construction due to diffusion. And if you've had, when without a gap, a moisture amount of 0.5 gram per square meter a day could enter the construction due to diffusion effects. So 0.5 gram is, if you empty your glass, then 0.5 gram is the rest of water that you can see at the bottom of the glass. It's just a very small amount of water. So what do you think if we add a gap of 1 millimeter thickness and 1 meter length to this situation? How much moisture could get into the construction during one day? It's 800. 800 grams per day is quite a lot. After 12 days, you have got a bucket full of water entering this construction. And even if you reduce the length of the gap to 10 centimeters, it's still 80 grams a day. And you can calculate by yourself what this does mean for the construction. It's a lot of moisture that could enter the construction due to leakages in the air tightness layer. And that's why it's very important to perform air tightness tests. Because as long as you haven't performed an air tightness test, the construction couldn't be considered as to be airtight. This is very important. And this is leading to building damages. And even small leakages. So here you've got the ruler, and obviously somebody has forgotten to finish the connection to this beam, could cause mold growing on the backside of the wood fiber board, and we have to avoid it. Because it could be possible that people are having mold in their construction, but they don't see it. If it's getting more, they could smell it. After a couple of years, you can smell this rottenness starting in your constructions, but then it's far too late. And we could do something else. We could prepare our construction. We could use a second dryout layer at the inside of the construction, a layer that hinders the moisture from getting into the construction during the winter due to a high diffusion resistance, and allows the moisture to dry out to the inside as well due to reducing the diffusion resistance. And this is what we call humidity variability. This is the intelligent part of the air tightness. And once you've installed a membrane like this, you are increasing the safety level of the construction enormously. And it's the best if this layer has got a BBA approval, because the BBA approval makes sure that the air tightness layer is tested concerning the abilities, the technical abilities, the durability, and you are having, or the BBA, it was developing guidelines for installing these materials in combination with other materials. It's very important to activate this inner dryout layer due to a humidity variable vapor check. A standard PE foil is not variable. Humidity variability is dependent on the surrounding relative humidity levels. A PE foil always has got the same diffusion resistance. Depends on the thickness of the material. So in this example, we've got an SD value of 100 meters. Very diffusion tight. This material is not offering a dry out capacity because what you can see here is the effect of summer condensation. Summer condensation could occur when it's getting very warm at the outside and moisture is trapped within the construction and the moisture is not dry out to the outside. Then due to the high temperatures, the moisture is driven to the inside and it condensates at the backside of the PE foil. So you can see it. You can see a kind of fog. The backside of the PE foil is covered. And then the humidity variable vapor checks are very interesting because these situations could be avoided when the vapor check is able to open the structure to reduce the diffusion resistance and let the moisture dry out. Then you don't have the situation. Or you just have it for a very small period of time. And this is the advantage of the humidity variability. You can get rid of the moisture. If the construction is diffusion open at the outside or diffusion tight, it doesn't matter. It's important that you use your second dry out layer, you activate your second dry out layer at the inside, and then you have constructions on a higher safety level. This is the humidity variable function of the Intello, Intello Plus and DB Plus. So here you can see that at an average humidity of 40%, that is quite usual during the winter periods, we've got an SD value of more than 20 meters, so a rather high diffusion resistance. You remember, SD value 30 meters is only half a gram per square meter that could enter the construction due to diffusion. And if it's needed, probably you have had some moisture accumulation during the winter. Then if it gets warmer during spring and summer, the membrane could reduce the diffusion resistance to 0.25 meters, which is rather similar to diffusion open roof underlays, and let the moisture dry out very easily. So humidity variable vapor checks are supporting the dry out capacity of the constructions. This is the theory behind it. And I would like to give you some numbers because we have performed calculations concerning the amount of water that could leave the construction due to using a humidity variable vapor check. And we have done it for a construction that is diffusion tight at the outside. Of course, this is the biggest problem that could occur. So we have got a bituminous membrane, on top a flat roof membrane, below a timber decking 24 mils, then fibrous insulation material 200 millimeters, a couple of vapor checks that we have performed the calculations for to compare the different dryout capacities, and then a surface cavity, of course, and a gypsum board. So standard construction. We've performed the calculations with a hydrothermal analysis tool called WUFI. I guess that some of you have heard this name. It was developed by the Fraunhofer Institute for Building Physics about 20 years ago. It's quite common for performing these analyses. With the WUFI software, you can calculate constructions under realistic conditions. So with climates, with the behavior of the material, with whatever. So the WUFI software shows how the dry out behaves during the following years. So we start here in this sample at more than 5 liters. Oh, what I've forgotten. We have put 4 liters of extra moisture into the insulation layer. So 4 1-liter bottles of moisture we have put into the insulation, and we wanted to find out how quick this moisture could dry out the construction. And so we start at 5.4 liters. So the 4 liters and the moisture content of the timber, of the gypsum board, and so on. And with the Intello membrane, we can nearly dry out the 4 liters within the first year. 3,200 grams per square meter a year dry out capacity offers the construction with a bituminous felt at the outside in combination with the Intello membrane at the inside for the safety of the construction. In comparison, a standard VCL with an SD value of 5 meters, it's not so diffusion tight, has only got about 400-500 grams per square meter. It's not enough for the safety of a construction. And if you consider the PE foil, the vapor barrier, SD value of 100 meter, then this is the red line, then you can see that no dryout capacity is available in this construction. In this situation, the construction would fail and would end up in a building damage. So if you install a humidity variable vapor check in the inside, you will have the most possible dryout capacities for the construction, even if it's diffusion open in the, at the outside due to using a wood fiber board or a roof underlay, or if it's diffusion tight due to installing a flat roof membrane. Sometimes it's necessary to have these membranes, or an existing building with a bituminous felt on top of timber decking. So and this defines the freedom from potential freedom from building damage defines the security level of the constructions. The higher the amount of moisture that could dry out is, the more security you have got into your construction. And this is what we have to avoid. So we don't want the insulation getting black. We don't want to have the mold growing in our constructions. Here you can see another sample of summer condensation. So the damp starts to condensate at the inside of the construction because it's not allowed to dry out due to the high diffusion resistance of the vapor barrier inside. But we also have to keep an eye on the details. Nye already mentioned it. You have to find solutions for cable penetrations. You have to find solutions if you don't have a service cavity. Of course, you are having tubes passing the vapor barrier and air tightness layer. If you can avoid it, avoid it. So it could be possible, if you organize your building site differently, that the electrician will start his work when the air tightness layer has been installed. Then you can avoid cable penetrations, because otherwise he will install the cable somewhere and the person who is doing the air tightness job has to seal a lot of cable penetrations. But on the other hand, if the cable is already there, then you have to find a solution, and the solution could not be only using two strips of tapes, because this is not a durable solution. We recommend to use grommets, prefabricated grommets that are very easy to install and that could serve as a good solution for a durable air tightness for the next decades. As a summary, when we are planning an insulated construction, we have to keep an eye on the diffusion, of course. We have to find a vapor check that is able to that can hinder the moisture from getting into the construction. And we also have to keep in mind that there is a moisture content of the building materials that we are using. So we have to make sure that the moisture could get out of the construction again. And even if we perform a blowout testing, it could be possible that we find unavoidable leakages. Because you never know what happens at the building site. You never know what happens, what the owners of the building are doing. They are pulling screws through the air tightness layer because they don't know that it's a very important layer. So what your construction needs is a very high dry out capacity, and then it's a safe construction. This is what I wanted to tell you about air tightness. Thank you.